بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
بسم الله الحمد لله رب العالمين، بسم الله الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، أما بعد. Praise and thanks our Allah for giving us this opportunity to continue where we have started in level one. That is a ni'mah from Allah. We say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Level two, inshaAllah, is going to be the second level or the second part of As-Saf. And as described in the invite or in the ad, that we are going to take two books besides that. The first book is the 40 Nawawi Hadith and the edition of Ibn Rajab, which completes or which makes 50 Hadith. Those 50 Hadith are comprehensive of great principles and foundations of this religion, as it will be explained, inshallah, in its time. And the second book will be Matn al-Akhdari. Matn al-Akhdari is a concise treatise in the Maliki Madhab. And the reason why this book was chosen is because of its contents. It contains, or it starts off with mentioning the importance of starting your knowledge with Aqeedah. Then it speaks about the important characteristics every Muslim should be upon. So it mentions a number of manners and characteristics every Muslim should be upon and what he should avoid. Speaks about, for example, lying, backbiting, the dangers of the tongue, other things that every Muslim should avoid, especially the major sins. Then it speaks about the rulings of purification, and prayer up to sujood as-sahw. And one of the good things about this book is that it mentions in detail the rulings of sujood as-sahw. That means that when the person or when the Muslim finishes this book, he is going to be well backed in knowledge about his prayer. Because everything that might happen to him in his prayer, he'll be upon sure knowledge on what to do. So, and this, as we know, we are not going to follow this book blindly, but we are going to use it to educate ourselves, inshallah, in the matters of salah. If there is an issue which the evidence supports otherwise, then we are going to mention to you the strongest opinion, inshallah, and the evidence supporting it. Otherwise, how it should be is that the beginner in knowledge should not occupy himself with matters of dispute. Said the beginner in knowledge should not occupy himself with matters of dispute, because the matters of dispute are not his shoes. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Min husni Islam al-mar, tarkuhu ma la yani." And this will come in the hadith. Min husni Islam al-mar, yani of the good Islam, of the good submitting of a person, is that he leaves off that which does not concern him. So the matters of dispute, they don't concern you in the sense that you are not yet in a position to weigh between the two opinions and see which of them is closest to the proof. But you have to take that directly from the teacher or the sheikh whom you are studying under. So we are only going to mention matters of dispute as a necessity. Yet when we come across an opinion in what we are going to read, where there are other opinions which might be stronger and closer to the dalil, then we will mention which is stronger. And the point from this book is not to abide blindly by a certain madhab, but to understand how the a'immah, how our guiding scholars derive the rulings from the evidence, from the Qur'an and the Sunnah. This is the 14 Nawawi Hadith, and this is considered to be the best print out there. It is Dar al-Minhaj, as you can see. Dar al-Minhaj. It's very easy to get. This Arba'un is the only full text. It's the only full text. It means very few or rare prints that have been printed before printed the whole book. This is the whole book. What were the previous prints missing? They were missing, some of them were missing the introduction. And Imam Nawawi has an introduction to this book. And he doesn't straight away mention the hadith. He says, "An Amir al-Mu'mineen, Abi Hafs al-Umar al-Khattab." No. He gives, there is an introduction in about 5 pages where he speaks about the point from writing this book and some principles regarding the hadith. Then at the end of this book also, he specified a chapter where he explains some of the words that are in the hadith, some of the words which are not commonly used, which need to be explained. So this print here is the best one because it printed the whole book and it depended upon important manuscripts. And some of them are linked with a chain of narration to Imam al-Nawawi himself. This is Al-Arba'un al-Nawawiyya. So this is what we are going to take, insha'Allah, for Al-Hadith. As for Matn al-Akhbari, This is Mat al-Akhdarin. As you can see, all the books are small treaties but contain big knowledge. Mat al-Akhdarin, this is the version, this is the whole version. There are two versions. The original one is the normal text, but this is a whole. Yani al-Akhdarin, this book was made into a whole. And this is commonly followed by the people of knowledge. They would come to a certain subject or a certain book and they would turn it into a poem. And the point from that, or the reason behind that, is to make it easy to facilitate memorizing those books by the student of knowledge, especially if it was a book like this in the contemporary wordings of As-Salah. So this is Nadhm al-Akhdarin. It is also available in the bookstores. The third, which we are going to start with, inshallah, is Tasrif al-Izzi. Of course, we are supposedly taking number two of Saf, but we are going to do a revision, a quick revision, and this revision will be included in the explanation of this book. Tasrif al-Izzi. Tasrif al-Izzi is a concise and abbreviated book on As-Sarf. Tasrif al-Izzi, as you can see, it's very small book. And in a small number of pages where it mentions the most important issues in this science. In this course, inshallah, in this level, we are going to demonstrate what we have learned in level 1 and what we are going to learn in level 2 on all of the ahadith that we are going to take, and also on any text that we are going to take besides that. So that, inshallah, the student of knowledge does not finish this course except that he is fully capable of applying the principles that he learned himself on any text that he comes across. So this means that we are going to take all the verbs that are in the ahadith, and by the end of this course you should be aware of all the verbs, what chapters they belong to, what meanings they give, what different meanings they give, and how is it translated when it's in the hadith. Of course, we did mention before that we are going to start with an hadith, then Arabic. But because Arabic is quite rich, we decided to start with it. So, inshallah, from now henceforth, the first hour will be on Arabic in both days, and the second hour on Friday will be the hadith. And on Saturday will be al-fiqh bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. So any question before we start regarding what we have mentioned?
Where can you find the Tasrif al-Izzi?
Tasrif al-Izzi is...
I tried in Maktab Sahaba, they didn't have
it. Have you went to Al-Bukhari in Dubai?
No, where is it?
It's most likely that you'll find it there. Al-Bukhari, Maktab al-Imam al-Bukhari is... next to the station, what's that station called? Yep. Abu Hair, yes. You know Abu Hair Mall?
Abu Hair,
right after it.
Maktab.
Yes. Maktabat al-Masjidat al-Imam al-Bukhari. Now, any other inquiries regarding those three books or what we have mentioned? Thank you. Now,
Which madhab
are we going to study?
No, which madhab did you train in?
Which madhab did I study in? Well, we have studied the Hanbali madhab. This is what, since we have studied in Mecca, then you will know that the Saudi madhab which is followed there is the Hanbali madhab. But as we said before, the madhab is not to be taken as something that is blindly followed, but as something that we benefit from in understanding how the scholars derive the rulings from the evidence. And they all have the same approach, whether it is the Hanbali or the Maliki or the Hanafi or the Shafi'i. All scholars have the same approach to the Quranic text and to the Ahadith from the aspect of the principles they have agreed on. So all of the A'imma, they wanted to follow the Hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All of them, without exception. That's why Imam Shafi'i says, إِذَا صَحَّ الْحَدِيثِ فَهُوَ مَذْهَبِي. يعني if the hadith is authentic, then it is my opinion. What does the word madhab mean? We said the word madhab means what? The opinion that the scholar is upon and dies upon it. This is basically what a madhab is. So if you follow the guidance of a mufti, if you ask one of the people of knowledge about an issue concerning your religion and he gives you the answer and you act upon it, then you are acting upon a madhab, whether you like it or not. Why? Because the word madhab means what? Means the opinion of the scholar which he chose and died upon. So al-Shafi'i says here what? إِذَا صَحَّ الْحَدِيثِ فَهُوَ مَذْهَبِي. يعني if the hadith is authentic, then I choose the opinion which the hadith supports, even if I didn't say it. And this, no doubt, they are teaching the students that we are not to be followed blindly, but the one who is to be followed blindly is who? Is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's why Imam al-Shafi'i himself said to his student, Imam Ahmad, he said, إِذَا كَانَ الْحَدِيثُ صَحِيحًا. If the hadith was authentic and you knew about it, then tell me about it. See? So the point is, they wanted to follow the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam just as long as it reached them. But if the hadith did not reach you, especially in those early days, are you put to account if you don't follow it? No, because you only did what was in your scope. That's why Imam Abu Hanifa was in a time of fitna in Iraq. So many of the ahadith that had reached him, even though they were later, it was later agreed upon that they are authentic hadith, but because he used to be very careful in accepting the hadith and trusting the narrator, he left some hadith and did not act upon it, because he saw that it did not reach to a level of authenticity which he was comfortable with. So if he does not follow this hadith because he's not convinced fully that this is all the word of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is he to blame? No. Same thing that Imam Malik, same thing that Imam Ahmed. Especially that al-Shafi'i said, even though Imam Ahmed says, I memorize a million ahadith, but he himself, who memorizes a million ahadith, that's a great number. That means he memorized most of the authentic and non-authentic ahadith. So that's a great number. Even he said, لا تقلدني ولا تقلد مالكا ولا الشافعي. ولكن خذ من حيث أخذ. Even he said this, لا تقلدني, means don't follow me blindly. Neither follow الشافعي blindly, nor مالك, but take from where they have taken. Take from where they have taken. And that is why Imam Malik said, if I say something in the Quran or in the Hadith is something besides that, then throw my opinion against the wall. And al-Shafi'i said, يعني, a word which is alike. So now you understand, barakallahu fikum, that the the position many people today take from this madhab issue is not the blame does not fall on the a'imma, but the blame falls on the followers of the a'imma who went to extreme when following the madhab, saying that it is correct and whatever besides it is wrong. This is what is wrong. So the mistake did not happen from the a'imma. The mistake happened from those who followed the a'imma after. Some of them, not all of them of course, the big students, the big students of the a'imma would never do this. But it is always the small students who are smaller in knowledge who are extreme, especially in the beginning of religion. That's why you find the most people who are extreme are the people who just entered the religion or who just started practicing. Well, then you find the people who grew in knowledge, their knowledge grew, they were on a great deal of knowledge. Say, the more knowledge you have, the less you will, your inkar will be, the less your forbidding will be. Why? Because you know that this is a matter of dispute and they are different investigations, especially in a certain hadith could not be entirely clear in the position or the ruling that it gives. So here, where is the problem? The problem is not from the imam, no doubt. So we believe that there is no imam of the imam of al-Muslimin, the trusted imam, that wanted to not follow the hadith deliberately. There's no such thing as an imam of the imam of al-Islam who did not want to follow the Prophet, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But sometimes, as we say, there are reasons why there is a dispute. This is an issue. Another issue that when knowledge was taken from the people of knowledge, it was honored, alhamdulillah. But when knowledge was written down in books, a lot of people entered in knowledge and they were not qualified to speak about knowledge. And some of them even depended on the books, and that is why these disputes, matters of dispute have arisen. Otherwise, a lot of the things that the a'imma have agreed on are now the center of doubt. A lot of the things that the a'imma of Islam have agreed upon are now matters of dispute. But if you go back to the early ages, you see that they have agreed upon this issue and there was no dispute at all. Like the issue of music, which is now arising, and people are trying to prove that music is halal and all that. There is a unanimous agreement before. So if there is a matter of dispute after that unanimous agreement, it is not acted upon. And it is disregarded and not considered. Why? Because they have agreed upon it from before. So whatever dispute comes after an agreement, is what is disregarded. So that is why one of the scholars of the 6th century, the 500s, he said, when people who were not qualified spoke in matters of knowledge, and he said, if the people who weren't clarified did not speak in the matter of knowledge, the dispute will fall. The dispute will fall. He's in the 500s. He said, if a person who had no knowledge abstained from speaking in matters of knowledge, the dispute will eventually fall. So it is only, the dispute only came and became stronger when people started speaking in matters that don't concern them. So this is why we say, if you want to reach to the higher levels of knowledge, you can. But follow the right steps in doing so. And don't start with which is less important. Start with which is most important. Start with the main issues of knowledge first. And then insha'Allah, when you understand them, only then can you understand these smaller issues. Or the issues which are less important. Wallah barakallahu fikum. And we said before, and we will say again, that the key to beneficial knowledge and to understanding the Quran and the Sunnah is what? Is Arabic. And this is agreed upon as well. This is unanimously agreed upon ever since the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this does not, we don't need to depend in this issue on al-ijma, because al-Qur'an says it ever so clearly. إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنَ الْعَرَبِيَّ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the beginning of Surah Yusuf, we have revealed it down in Arabic Qur'an that you may understand. So, learning the Arabic is a means to understanding the Qur'an. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not send out a messenger except with the language of his people. And the Prophet, al-Qur'an was revealed down on the Arabs. And it was revealed down on a Nabi who is Arabi. It was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the beginning of Surah Ibrahim, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا بِلِسَانِ قَوْلِهِ. We have not sent out a messenger except with the language of his people. لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ. To clarify to them. So the clarification of this Qur'an depends on this Arabic language. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent every messenger with the language of his people. And that is why al-Shafi'i said, أَهْلُ الْعَرَبِيَّةِ جِنُّ الْإِنْسِ يَرَوْنَ مَا لَا يَرَوْنَ. أَهْلُ الْعَرَبِيَّةِ جِنُّ الْإِنْسِ. The people of Arabic are the jinn of mankind. They see what mankind don't see. Yani the one who has the Arabic, he sees things that the person who does not Arabic, who does not have Arabic, see. Why? Because he knows the combination, this combination of words, what does it imply, and what every word means, and if it has different meanings, and if it is used in a certain context, what does it mean, and if it is used in another context, what does it mean? It has different meanings. So he could see things and understand things that the person who's illiterate in Arabic cannot understand. That's why the Sahaba already had that. You might say, well, why didn't the Sahaba preach that? So they didn't need to, because they had that. It was a second nature to them. They were Arabs. They were the people of this tongue. But when the Islamic Empire grew vast, and a lot of people, a lot of non-Arabs came into Islam, and yani, it was needed that there be, that those principles were written down to preserve this language, the scholars went and simply wrote down what they had of the principles of their language. So they simply wrote down what was already there. So they didn't do anything new except compiling, except the compilation of what? Of the principles that they have already, that they already have and they already follow in their speech. And this is said about all the other sciences as well. And don't think that al-fiqh and Arabic and all of those sciences are sciences that weren't there, that are completely innovated. So no, it's not completely innovated. It was there. But the only difference is, it is now in books. Organized in a certain way. Principle after principle. But before, it was a second nature. That's why you see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaking about many, and he is speaking in many Islamic fields and mentioning many principles in his speech. But simply, what did the scholars do? They took and derived the principles from the different hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then they started classifying the different fields of Islamic knowledge. That's all of what they have done. And they did a lot of research then. The scholars did a lot of lot of work on following and analyzing the speech of the Arabs and making sure that they haven't left off any principle that was necessary to be noted down and to be kept. And this is part of preserving this religion. See, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we know as Muslims that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserved this Quran from being corrupted by the hands of men like it was, like the books before were. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ in Surah Al-Hijr. Verily, we have sent down this dhikr, and we are going to safeguard it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserved this Quran from being changed. It was narrated generation after generation just as it is, without any change, not even in one tashkeel, in one haraka, not even in one letter. And since, as we said before, since this Quran was preserved, then it was necessary that the thing by which you understand this Quran was preserved. And this means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserved the Sunnah as well. And since you cannot understand the Quran except with the Sunnah, and you cannot understand the Quran and the Sunnah except with Arabic, Allah preserved the Arabic language as well. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala facilitated all the means and reasons for all of these sciences to be kept and preserved until now. That's why you see all the books of the scholars, who have passed away more than 1,200 years ago are available now. The manuscripts are available now. And they were copied generation after generation by hand, not by the civilized means of copying that we have today. Scholars would copy those books by hand. They would write the whole book, even if it was in 20 volumes, 50 volumes. They would write down, every student would copy the book of his sheikh. He would take the book of his sheikh and he would copy it with his own hand. And not one does that. Many students do that. You get physical proof of those books that the scholars have written until this very day. All those books that you see in the bookstore, they don't come out just like that. They don't come out in a day or two. They come out after years of investigating, years of verifying the different manuscripts and seeing if there is any difference between a manuscript and another. And a book, of course, this is before the book, the scholar used to spend 20 years until he gets, he prints a certain book. He might work on it 20 years. Today, a person could publish a book in a month. But before, because of the ikhlas of the scholars, they used to really work hard on giving us a sound and correct text of the book from the manuscript. Not saying that there's no ikhlas today, of course. There are many sincere people who are striving to spread the deen of Allah and to work on the on spreading knowledge. But I'm saying it wasn't like it was before. But the point is, it is kept until now. And the proof is this. Look, for example, Al-Arba'un al-Nawawi kept until this day. Al-Imam al-Nawawi died in the 600s. Yani, how many years? Huh? 800 years back. And the different explanations of this book are kept also until this day. Al-Bukhari, who died more than 1,200 years ago, his book is still kept until now, etc. Wa barakallahu feekum. So this answers your question. Any other question? So the madhab, basically, we do not have the tools that the scholars have to derive the rulings from the Quran and the Sunnah. So we are just like the infants with their mothers. Just like the babies with their mothers. They depend fully on their mothers to get the proper nutrition. They do not have the ability to feed themselves. It's the same thing in matters of knowledge. In matters of knowledge, there are many tools that you have to obtain before speaking in matters of knowledge. If one of them in Arabic, for example, and one of the A'imma said that whoever did not know Arabic, it is not permissible for him to speak about the religion of Allah, not even one letter. Shouldn't utter anything, not even one single word about the religion of Allah. This is only Arabic. What about the rest of the tools? So the scholar, in order for him to investigate, and in order for him to have the right to investigate and speak about the religion of Allah, first he has to have the Arabic language. He has to be fully versed and backed by the Arabic language. And this is a unanimous agreement by the scholars. He has to know the Qur'an and the tafsir. He has to know that which was abrogated from the Qur'an and that which was not abrogated, and from the Sunnah as well. He has to know a great deal of the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He has to know the ijma', yani what are the matters or the issues which the scholars have agreed upon. So these are five tools, and each one of them need much time to obtain. For you to know the tafsir of the verses of the Quran, for you to know the rulings which are abrogated and not, for you to know the ijma'at, yani the unanimous agreements of the scholars, for you to know the Arabic language, which is alone 12 sciences. 12 sciences, the Arabic language. But the most important ones are five. And later the five, three of them were compiled into one. So there are three important sciences as a first step for you to start understanding, as the companions used to understand the minute they hear the verse or they hear the hadith. They did not need much effort to understand the verse on the hadith because they had those sciences as well. It was a second nature to them. So in order for you to understand, just like the Sahaba understood, you have to have the same tools they had. In order for you to understand, just like the Sahaba did, you have to have the same tools they had. So this is a serious attempt to show the people the right steps of knowledge and for the people to obtain the necessary tools for them to at least understand, if not reach to a level where they get to derive or investigate in the different verses of the Quran and the Hadith, but at least to understand how the scholars do it. And once you understand how the scholars do it, the whole point of all of this is to obtain piety. To obtain piety is to act upon the knowledge which you know, which you gain. Wadih barakallahu feekum. So there's a big misconception that today, even among the beginners of the students of knowledge, there's a great misconception, which is that if you follow a madhab, that means you are discarding the hadith. This is a great misconception, false statement. You do not have the tools to understand the hadith by yourself. And I can prove this to you right now. For example, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, سباب المسلم فسوق وقتاله كفر. سباب المسلم فسوق وقتاله كفر. What does this mean? If you take the mere translation of this, or if you get any book of any of the Sunan, hadith and merely translates it as it reads. Say, this hadith would read in English, it would say, Sibab al-Muslim al-Fusuq, cursing a Muslim, is sinfulness, and fighting him is a disbelief. If we would translate word by word, he would come up with this meaning. Now, a person who reads without having the necessary tools, not just Arabic, but the rest of the principles by which he understands the matters of knowledge, if he did not have knowledge, he said, okay, so if a person fights me, that means he's a disbeliever. Correct? And this is not what is meant, because the word kufur is used for two meanings. For that which is considered to be an act of disbelief, and for that which is not. So if he does not know the different usages of one single word in the language, he will go astray, because he does not know. And those sects who are of Muslims, who are killing the Muslims everywhere, they only deviated because of this. That's why one of the early ancient scholars said, مَا تَزَنَّقَ مُتَزَنِّقٌ فِي الْمَشْرِقِ إِلَّا لِجَهْلِهِ بِكَلَامِ الْعَرَبِ. Yani not a person deviated from this religion except because of his ignorance in the language of the Arabs, in the speech of the Arabs. Many examples. For example, an example that I mentioned in one khutbah, that there's a hadith which says that if you're invited to a feast, if your brother invites you to a feast, and you are fasting, and the hadith says, فَلْيُصَلْ. If we take a mere translation of this word, فَلْيُصَلْ means let him pray. Okay? So the person who does not have the necessary knowledge will say, okay, if I was invited and I was fasting, I'll just pray two rak'ahs. And this is not what is meant. Because the term salah has a linguistic meaning and a religious meaning. And the Prophet ﷺ did not mean the religious meaning of the word salah, which is the act that we do, the five prayers. No, he meant making dua. How do we know this? This is explained in another narration. There's another narration which says فَلْيَدْعُ instead of فَلْيُصَلْ. So it explained that the salah, which the Prophet ﷺ meant in the first narration, is ad-du'a. That means if you were invited and you were fasting, make du'a for the one who has invited you. So how do we know this? See, if we know the other ahadith. A hadith might seem to you sufficing, but it is not, because there might be exceptions to this hadith in other ahadith. There might be further conditions in other ahadith. For example, a person might read a book and he sees, for example, that al-wudu or al-tahara, purification, is a condition to prayer. But he doesn't know that covering your awra is a condition to prayer as well. So if he acts upon that, is it enough? It is not enough, because he does not know the other ahadith. Some people read, for example, in the hadith, that whoever dies saying La ilaha illallah will enter paradise. And he thinks that if he says La ilaha illallah, no matter what he does, he's going to paradise, even if he commits shirk. And this is a big wrong understanding as well, because there are other ahadith mentioning other conditions to La ilaha illallah, that you have to act upon it, that you have to know what it means, that you have to avoid whatever contradicts this word. There are things which contradict this word. There are things which break this word. So you see, barakallahu feekum, you cannot, or we cannot, follow the hadith by itself without the guidance of the scholars who have the tools to understand it correctly. So the scholar tells you, when he teaches you the hadith, he tells you this hadith has an exception, and the exception is mentioned in that verse. The exception is mentioned in that hadith. This hadith, this word, is not what it seems, but this has another meaning, because this word in the Arabic language has many meanings, and this meaning is the one meaning which is meant. Why? Because of another hadith supporting this meaning, or clarifying that this meaning is meant right here. There's a verse, for example, in the Quran, where it says that you are not allowed to marry a disbeliever. But there's another verse in the Quran which states that you can marry the chaste women of the people of the scripture. Is this a contradiction? No. So the scholar tells you, this verse specifies this verse. That means you are not allowed to marry a disbelieving woman except the ones of the scripture from them. The ones from the people of the scripture of them. So the scholar tells you, wait, this verse, even though it is general, but there is something that specifies it and makes an exception to this ruling, to this general ruling. Sometimes the person might not be aware that a certain ruling is abrogated. Like al-wasiyyah, for example. Al-will, the will. After al-mirath, there is no will in something that is going to be inherited, for example. If the person does not know that this was abrogated, he might act upon something that was left. Zawaj al-mut'ah. Al-mut'ah is marrying for a prescribed period, not forever, but marrying for a certain period. This was permissible in the first days, in the early days, but then it was later prohibited. It was forbidden. If you see, read a hadith in al-Mut'ah, and you're not aware of the other hadith that states that this was abrogated, what will happen? You're going to deviate. Wadih barakallahu fikum. So, follow the Quran and the Sunnah, but if you don't have the necessary tools, can you follow the Quran and the Sunnah correctly? You cannot, because you don't have the tools. So, following a madhab basically is depending on the scholar's understanding of the correct understanding of the Quran and the Hadith. So, when you abide by a certain madhab, you basically observe and start to train yourself on how the scholars, you start to observe, how does a scholar understand this ruling from this verse, how does he understand this ruling from that hadith. So you slowly train yourself into reaching to that same level, the level where you are able to derive the ruling or to understand the ruling in the same manner the scholars of Islam have understood it. Wadih barakallahu fikum. This is basically the issue of following the madhab and not following the madhab. Now, if you had a detailed description on how the scholar thinks, detailed description, a fully detailed description of how the imam works his way into knowing that this hadith implies this ruling, this verse implies this ruling. This is what's going to help you obtain the tools. Because you have a detailed description of how the imam thinks, how the scholar investigates in the Quran and the Sunnah. So these four madahib, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided that it has many followers. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided that the different aspects of this madhab, of this school, is completely written down and made so ever clear that there is no opinion that the imam has said except it is written down. And it is explained thoroughly and in detail. So when you have a clear vision on how the imam studies the verse, this is going to be your learning resource on how to obtain those tools. Going to learn, inshallah. Because today is only an introduction. what is coming ahead. Of course, we are going to study three different topics. The first one is a sunnah, the second one is a arabiyya, and the third is al fiqh. So we have to know what each of the three mean. So a sunnah has a linguistic meaning and a technical meaning. The term as sunnah has a linguistic meaning and a technical meaning. And so are all the terms, most of the scientific terms that we will come across or that we will use in our classes, they have both a linguistic meaning and a technical meaning. And what did we say is the difference between the linguistic meaning and the technical meaning?
The linguistic meaning is a generalized meaning, but the technical and specific meaning.
Very good. Says the linguistic meaning is a generalized meaning. And the technical one is a specific version of that meaning. What else? Yes?
Literal meaning and consumption.
Very good. So he says the linguistic meaning is a literal meaning. That means the meaning that the Arabs wanted from that word. Okay? The meaning which the Arabs wanted for that word. Not only the Arabs, every language. In every language. Now, for example, the word injection. Injection. In the English language. What does it mean linguistically? To put something into something else. Linguistically, does it mean the injection that the doctors know? Or that the doctors mean? No, it doesn't mean that linguistically. But putting anything into something is called injecting. This is what a linguistic meaning. So it is no specific injecting. But any injection is called an injection. Correct? Now what have the doctors done? They went and have taken this word from the literal linguistic usage and they used it for a specific type of injection. Understood? This is called the technical usage and it is referred to in Arabic as istilah. It is referred to as istilah. Istilah. We have to understand this to understand everything which is coming ahead. You have to understand the difference between lugha and istilah. What is lugha and what is istilah? Lugha is the linguistic meaning. Istilah, that meaning which was specified from the linguistic meaning. Okay, istilah is a group a specific group using a word after moving it linguistic usage and I have just given you an example. So here, for example, we have the word injection. Injection in the linguistic meaning, you know what it is. So the doctors who are a specific group went to that word from the English vocabulary and used it for a specific meaning after moving it from its original meaning. Understood? Okay? You have the word operation. What does operation mean linguistically?
To do something.
To do something. Okay? Or to work on a certain task. This is called an operation. Is the operation linguistically, does it necessarily mean the surgery? No. But linguistically, it is any type of operation. It is general. But the doctors, they took that word and they used it for a specific type of that general meaning. Understood? Same thing you have in where? In the Islamic sciences. You have a meaning which is general, and that is the linguistic meaning, then you have a meaning which is specific. So now we take the word as-sunnah. Now we take a word, let's understand what as-sunnah means. There's a big misconception about the word as-sunnah. Many confusion, many complication. Why? This goes back to the people not making a difference between the linguistic meaning and the technical meaning to the word as-sunnah. So as-sunnah, what does it mean linguistically and what does it mean technically? Linguistically, the word as-sunnah means the way. Now I told you before, the linguistic meaning is general. What does general mean? Unspecified. Specify. Whereas the technical meaning is what? Specific.
Knowledgeable people in their field.
Yes, a group, as we said. Okay? Specific. So, the term as-sunnah. As-sunnah. This term, you have to know what it means to the Arabs, then what it means to that certain group. Technical meaning could also, and one of the technical meanings is the Islamic meaning. Islamic meaning is a technical meaning. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses a certain word, He uses it for a specific meaning of the generalized meaning. And I give you an example to that. An example, ilm, al-ilm. Al-ilm, what does it mean? knowledge. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions an ilm in the Quran, does he mean any knowledge? Or the revelation? The revelation. He means Islamic knowledge. See? Because people don't know the difference between, or because people, many people are unaware that there is a technical meaning, an Islamic meaning to the term al-ilm, they thought that every ilm is good to seek. Or every ilm is necessary. Or every ilm, whoever obtains it, will fear Allah, for example. And that's not what this meant from the word al-ilm in the Quran and in the Sunnah. In the Quran and the Sunnah, al-ilm means Islamic knowledge, means the knowledge that came from above. This does not mean that we are neglecting the other worldly sciences or worldly knowledge. No. That is good, and that is even, it is necessary that someone seeks it and that someone obtains it for the benefit, for the general benefit of the ummah. It is necessary to have doctors, it is necessary to have chemists, it is necessary to have etc. But we are simply putting things in their places. When Allah mentions al-ulama, the scholars, who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking about? Speaking about the scholars as in the people who are knowledgeable in religion. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. Those who fear Allah as he should be feared are the scholars. Which scholars? Which knowledge? The knowledge of wizardry? The knowledge of geology? No. What is meant is the Islamic knowledge, yani the revelation. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَعْلَمُونَ ظَاهِرًا مِنَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ عَنِ الْآخِرَةِ غَافِلُونَ. See, this is a proof. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this in Surah Ar-Rum. As he criticized people for knowing much about the dunya and not knowing about the deen. Which is Surah Ar-Rum, Surah number 30, verse number 7. They know only an outside appearance of the life of this world, the matters of their livelihood, their irrigating or sowing or reaping, and they are heedless of the hereafter. This is Surah number 30, verse number 5, verse number 7. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he said, al-ulama'u warathatul anbiya. Al-ulama'u, the scholars are the inheritors from whom? From the prophets. Then he said, وَإِنَّ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ لَمْ يُوَرِّثُوا دِينَارًا وَلَا دِرْهَمًا. The prophets did not leave behind a worldly gain, but they have left knowledge. So if what they have left behind is no worldly gain, and if they left knowledge, so we would understand that the knowledge here means a specific type of knowledge, not every knowledge. Isn't that so? So here, what is the Islamic meaning of the word knowledge? Islamic knowledge. Another example. You have, for example, the word nusuk. Nusuk, what does it mean to the Arabs? Of course, what do you know from the word nusuk? Or let's not go to the word nusuk. Let's go to a word which you commonly know. Saum. What does saum mean? Fasting. What fasting? Which fasting? Fasting Ramadan. Very good. Fasting Ramadan. Abstaining from what? From food, from water, and whatever breaks your fast. Correct? Is this the linguistic meaning of the word saum? No. The word saum means abstaining from anything. That's why the Arabs say, خَيْلٌ صَائِمَاتِ. You know what are خَيْل? Horses. Horses that are صَائِمَاتِ. Yani that abstain from?
Running.
From running. خَيْلٌ صَائِمَاتِ. So, الصِّيَام is abstaining. What kind of abstaining? Unspecified. It's any abstaining is called some. But Allah transferred this word from the linguistic usage, and He specified that meaning of abstaining for some religiously to give the meaning of a certain and specific type of abstaining. And abstaining from food, water, and whatever breaks your fast. Not only that, in a specific time. Not only that, from a specific person. A sane adult. Wada? See? See the difference? Also, the word as-salah. Salah. What do you understand from the word salah? Salah. The prayer. That is not the meaning of the word salah linguistically. Linguistically, the word salah means dua. But because prayer was a dua in a specific way, it was called salah. But which meaning? Religious meaning. Both meanings are used in the Quran to a word salah. Both the linguistic meaning and the technical meaning are used in the Quran, in the same Quran. The example of the linguistic meaning to a word salah is the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah At-Tawbah, خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُطَهِّرُهُمْ وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا وَصَلِّ عَلَيْهِمْ إِنَّ صَلَاتَكَ سَكَنٌ لَهُ. Which is Surah number 9, verse number 103. Take sadaqah, alms, from their wealth in order to purify them and sanctify them with it and invoke Allah for them. صَلِّ عَلَيْهِمْ. If we take the word-to-word translation and we say صَلِّ عَلَيْهِمْ, if we translate it with the technical meaning, صلي عليهم, what would it mean? Pray on them. But what is that what is meant? Taking them as a mat and praying on them? No, that is not what is meant. But what is meant is the linguistic meaning to a word as-salah, which is dua. See? It says invoke Allah for them. This is a technical meaning. We find the same meaning or the same word used, but for another meaning. For a technical meaning. As in the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. In Surah Al-Baqarah, in the first verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ. Same word is used, but different meaning, specified meaning, different meaning. A different meaning than the meaning, than the original meaning. Okay? So now, we are going to study a sunnah. In here is a sunnah. What is a sunnah? A sunnah linguistically means the way. We find that linguistic meaning mentioned in the Quran. In Surah number 48, verse number 23, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, سُنَّةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِ وَلَنْ تَجِدَ لِسُنَّةِ اللَّهِ تَبْدِيلًا. Sunnat Allah means the way of Allah. So the word sunnah linguistically means what? Which way? Anyway, anyway is called a sunnah. Wadih? Now, the sunnah in religion in general means a specific way. It means the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that is the istilahi, the way of who? Of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What's the relationship between the first meeting? feeling in the second? What's the relationship? Is there a relationship?
Yes.
What is it?
The second one specifies
the first one. This is the main difference and relationship between two meanings. That means, if you wanted, without being told of the technical meaning, if you wanted to know what's the technical meaning to any word, know what it is linguistically, you shall know what it is technically, by knowing this difference. If you wanted to know what the meaning word or what the word means linguistically, and you had the technical meaning, you can do that simply by understanding that the technical meaning is a specific meaning of the general one. Also, the term as-sunnah is used linguistically for the matter which the person starts and others follow him. As in the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Man sanna fil Islam sunnatan hasana, falahu ajruha wa ajru man amila biha min ba'dihi." This is in Muslim, hadith number 1017. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Man sanna fil Islam sunnatan hasana." Yani, whoever starts a way which exists, but he starts it, and people follow him in that way, then he will get the reward of it and of the people doing it until the day of judgment. So this is a linguistic meaning to a word as sunnah, the matter which the person starts and others follow. So people who do not know the difference, they will understand the hadith in a wrong manner, as they have already. Wadih barakallahu feekum. So as sunnah technically means the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself called al-hadi. Al-hadi. الهدي أما بعد فإن خير الكلام كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل بدعة ضلالة. This is in Muslim as well, hadith number 867. This is referred to as الهدي. الهدي is what is
guidance.
Yani besides the Quran. The guidance which is besides the Quran is al-hadi. Al-hadi in this meaning means the general way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay? Now, this meaning would include the following. This meaning would include the following. Yani the meaning of a sunnah in istilah. Istilah means technical usage. Istilah means technical usage. Okay? A sunnah, which is the general way, includes four things. It includes the sayings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, number one. So number one, it includes what? The sayings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And an example to that is the hadith which Al-Bukhari narrated. Hadith number one, in chapter number one. And it is the first hadith that we are going to take, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ. This is part of his saying, this is what he said. So this is part of what is called what? This is part of what is called what? As-sunnah. So So his sayings are a part of what is called what? A sunnah. Therefore, this very saying of his, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ, this is called what? Sunnah. Does it mean that it is preferred? Does it mean that it is preferred? Again, I will ask again the question. We say, Sunnah in this meaning, the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it includes the following. Number one, it includes his sayings. And the example is, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ. This is part of his what? Sayings. عمر بن الخطاب said, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إنما الأعمال بالنيات. I heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم saying إنما الأعمال بالنيات. So إنما الأعمال بالنيات is part of what is called a sunnah, where technically his sayings are part of what? The sunnah. Part of the sunnah. So we say this very saying of his is called what? A sunnah. Nowadays, many people only know one meaning from the word a sunnah, which is what? The preferred act. That is the latest innovated meaning of the word a sunnah. Innovated in a good way. That is the latest. This meaning of the word as sunnah, yani, which is the preferred act, is used by the late scholars in a science which is called usul al-fiqh. Usul al-fiqh are the foundations of understanding. They wanted by this term as sunnah to imply what? The preferred acts. Some of them call it sunnah. Some of them call it nadb. And some of them call it nafila. Different technical terms to one meaning. But this is a term which was later originated. But the main originated term is the general way. So if I say, or if one of the people of knowledge says, this here is a sunnah, does he necessarily mean that it's preferred? No. See, a lot of people misunderstood the words of the scholars. So they think that whenever the scholar says this is a sunnah, it means what? It is preferred, and that's not how it is. Because the meaning, especially with the ancient scholars, with the Sahaba and the ones after them, they used the term sunnah not for that meaning, which is the preferred act. Because that meaning only came later. That usage, I mean, only came later. But they used it as sunnah. See, this is the sunnah, yani this is part of the way of whom? Of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is his sayings. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. This is in Al-Bukhari, hadith number one. Okay? The second thing which is included in what is called a sunnah is what? His actions, his doings. Okay? Take as an example, Abu Dawood, hadith number one, where it mentions that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever he wanted to go and do the needful, he would go far. He would go far. And whenever he wants to go to the toilet, he goes far away. This is what? An action. Abu Dawood. he refers to Abu Dhar. Okay? D, hadith number one. This is an action. This action, which is whenever wanting the ease of nature, you go far. This action is part of what is called a sunnah, in which meaning? Technical meaning. Wale. The third thing which the term a sunnah includes is his affirmations. His affirmations. There are many examples to this. One of the examples, for example, the hadith in al-Bukhari. Hadith number 3043, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked the slave woman, "Where is Allah?" Then she said, "What did she say?" "Fis-sama." This is another example that I will give you for the importance of Arabic. She replied, "Fis-sama." What did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say? Free her, she's a believer. Free her, she is a believer. This is what? An affirmation. Now, the most important thing is, what does fis-sama mean? What do you understand from fi? Fi, in. What do you understand from the word as-sama?
Sky.
Huh?
Sky.
The sky. Is Allah in the sky? Huh? Then why did the Prophet ﷺ affirm it? Because fi does not have one meaning. Fi does not only mean in. Sometimes it could mean on. Sometimes it could mean in. Sometimes it could mean on. This is another one aspect. Another aspect. The term as-sama, does it have only one meaning? No. The term as-sama could mean the sky and could mean whatever is above. That's why the Arabs say, "Where is Fulan?" They say, "Fis-sama." That means he's on the roof. Okay? And I give you a proof from the Quran, which supports as-sama meaning whatever is above. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أنزل من السماء ماء. أنزل. أنزل من السماء ماء. أنزل من السماء ماء. What does أنزل من السماء ماء mean? He brings down water from the sky or from above?
From the sky.
Let's see. Let Allah answer that. What is meant? Is it from the sky or from above? Let's see. In the Quran. First of all, where does the water come?
Clouds.
Clouds.
The clouds. Where are the clouds?
In the sky.
In the sky?
Above.
Allah says the clouds are between the earth and the sky. Allah subhanahu subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَالسَّحَابِ الْمُسَخَّرِ بَيْنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. لآيات لقوم يعقلون. Which is Surah number 2, verse number 164. The clouds which are held between the sky and the earth. Surah number 2, verse number 164. So Allah says here in this verse that the clouds are where? Between the earth and the sky. But he said in another verse, أَنْزَلَ مِنْ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً. It brings down the water from where? From السَّمَاء. If we say السَّمَاء is a sky, it will be a contradiction to the other verse. Because in the other verse, Allah says that the السَّحَاب, from where the water comes, is where? Between the sky and the earth. So what does السَّمَاء mean then, if it's not the sky?
Above.
It's from above. Where did we get this from? From the language of the Arabs. They sometimes use as-sama to indicate above. See, if you know Arabic, all the confusions will be cleared. Now, when the slave woman said fi sama, what did she mean?
Above.
He is above. If one argues, nobody can argue because this is in a thousand evidence in the Quran and the Sunnah, more than a thousand. It is agreed upon. Nobody but some sects, deviated sects in Islam, they argue this point. Even though the Sahaba all agreed upon it. It is the belief that everyone should believe. Whoever believes otherwise is having a big problem. Is close to disbelieving. So this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being above. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, الرحمن على العرش استوى. The most merciful rose above the throne. Where is the throne? There's above the seven heavens, there's a sea. And above the sea, there is the throne. And Allah is above the throne. So He's above everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above everything. Well, then. Now, if someone argues and says, but fi means in. Fi means in. What do we say? We say, fi does not necessarily mean in. It could be used for other meanings as well. Fi could sometimes be used to express on. So if one says, well, where is fi? What's your proof that fi could be used for on? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about Fir'aun, threatening his wizard, saying, وَلَأُصَلِّبَنَّكُمْ فِي جُذُوعِ النَّخْلِ. I shall crucify you فِي جُذُوعِ النَّخْلِ. جُذُوعِ النَّخْلِ is the trunk of the palm tree. The crucifixion, is it in the tree or on the tree? On the tree. So here, وَلَأُصَلِّبَنَّكُمْ, take for example, وَلَأُصَلِّبَنَّكُمْ فِي جُذُوعِ النَّخْلِ, Surah Taha, which is Surah number 20. Verse number 71. It says clearly here, we will surely crucify you on the trunks date palms on. Another clear example, clearer even, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ سِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ فَانْظُرُوا ثُمَّ انْظُرُوا كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الْمُكَذِّبِينَ. Say, go in the earth. Does it mean make tunnels in the earth and go inside them? No, it means on the earth. Where is this? This is in Surah Al-An'am, which is Surah number 6. In the very beginning of Surah Al-An'am, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ سِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ فَانْظُرُوا كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةٌ ثُمَّ انْظُرُوا كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةٌ. Say, O Muhammad, travel in the land and see what was the end of those who reject the truth. وَاضَحْ بَرَكَةٌ. See how Arabic solves every problem in understanding the religion. أو بَيَا. So, فِي السَّمَاء. So here, this is part of what this hadith is part of what? Part of what is called what? As-Sunnah. Then we have the as-sifat, the attributes of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His physical features, etc. As in Al-Bukhari, hadith number 3551, where it says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had hair reaching his ears. This is part of what is called what? As-Sunnah. But here, growing the hair, see, who doesn't have knowledge, would not differentiate between sunnat ibadah and sunnat adah. There's a sunnah, which is an act of worship of the acts of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is meant to be an act of worship, and there are acts which are not meant to be an act of worship, but it was a habit. It was a habit. Now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam growing his hair, was he doing it as a ritual, as an act of worship, or it was a habit? It was a habit. So no one can say, I will grow my hair to do like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, believing it is an act of worship. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not do it as an act of worship. And he is doing it as an act of worship because he is taking it like something that is preferred. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it as a ada, as a habit, and the person who did it as what? As a sunnah, in the sense, as an act which is preferred. See? But all of that is called a sunnah. Then there is some sunnahs are of different types. There's something which is meant to be followed and something which was not meant to be followed. There is some of the sunnah which is meant to be exclusively for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not for anyone else, like him marrying 9, etc. Like it being obligatory upon him to pray the night. قُمْ اللَّيْلَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. Then barakallahu feekum. Yes, we will allow questions inshallah at the end, inshallah. The last 15 minutes inshallah. Right. So the sunnah, we can understand from what we have explained, that the sunnah 5. That the Sunnah is whatever is attributed to the Prophet وسلم, of his sayings, doings, affirmations, and attributes. And attributes. And it is a shame for a Muslim who studies the Sunnah, or for any Muslim who does not know about the least about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we have to know about this Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Who is he? What is his main qualities? What is his name? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his position is that he is the best who has ever walked on the face of this earth. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ana sayyidu waladi Adam." ولا فخر. أنا سيد ولدي آدم. I'm the master of the sons of Adam. This hadith is narrated in Muslim, hadith number 2278. And this man, صلى الله عليه وسلم, is the last of all prophets. There is no prophet after him. As the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, وَإِنَّهُ لَا نَبِيَّ بَعْدِهِ وَإِنَّهُ لَا نَبِيَّ بَعْدِ. And this is in Al-Bukhari, hadith number 3455. Hadith number 3455. This great Prophet, because of his many qualities, he has many names. And this is also one of the principles in religion, that the more qualities something has, the more names it is given. This is a principle. That is why the Quran is called the Dhikr, it's called the Huda, it's called the Nur, it's called the Shifa, it's called the Furqan, it's called the Diya, it's called the Kitab. وَهَذَا ذِكْرٌ مُبَارَكٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ قُلْ هُوَ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا هُدًى وَشِفَاءٌ قل بفضل الله وبرحمته فبذلك فليفرحوا هو خير مما يجمعون. واضح. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has many names. Of his names is Muhammad. Of his names is Ahmad. Of his names is Al-Mahi. Of his names is Al-Aqib. Of his names is Al-Hashir. Of his names is Nabiul Malhama. Of his names is Nabiul Marhama. Of his names is Al-Ni'ma, Al-Rahma, Al-Hadi, Al-Bashir, Al-Nadhir, a Rasul, a Nabi. All of these different names. Why? Because of his many qualities. That's why a lot of scholars even gather those names in their books, some of them in verses of poetry. Muhammadun ma'al muqaffi ahmada al-hashiru wal-aqibu wal-mahirrada wa huwa al-musamma binabiyya al-rahmati fi muslimin wa binabiyya al-tawbati wa fihi aydan binabiyya al-malhama wa fi riwayati al-nabiyya al-marhama طه وياسين مع الرسول كذاك عبد الله في التنزيل والمتوكل النبي الأمي والرؤوف الرحيم أي رحمي وشاهدا مبشرا نذيرا كذا سراجا صبه منيرا كذا به المزمل المدثر وداعيا لله والمذكر ورحمة ونعمة وهادي وغيرها تجل عن بعدها. So one of the main qualities of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is Muhammad. Why was he named Muhammad? Because Muhammad, you will learn in Arabic that it is taken from Humida. Muhammad linguistically means someone who is praised time and time again. This is what the word, the actual word Muhammad means. Then it was taken and made a name for this great Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Muhammad, someone who is praised time and time again. And if he's praised time and time again, what would this mean? That there are many people who praise him, and that he has many qualities that are praiseworthy. So we mean two things. Of his name is Ahmed. What does Ahmed? Ahmed linguistically means one who praises in the best manner. Why was he called Ahmad? Because he is the best. He praises Allah the best, in the best manner. The one who praises Allah in the best manner is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why one of his names is Ahmad. وَمُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولٍ يَأْتِي مِنْ بَعْدِ اسْمُهُ Ahmad. One of his names is Al-Mahi. Why Al-Mahi? Al-Mahi means linguistically the eraser. Why? Because he erased Al-Kufr, disbelief. And he came with the call to worship Allah alone. Of his names is Al-Hashim. Why Al-Hashim? Al-Hashim, يعني the one whom the people will be resurrected after. Al-Hashim, one who gathers the people. Because the people will be, he is the first one to come out of the grave in the day of judgment. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Of course, يعني, we wanted to finish speak about the name of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his main qualities before we start. But inshaAllah, since there's no time, we will continue tomorrow inshaAllah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. And now we have 15 minutes for questions inshaAllah. No, Fadhil, you had a question? Yes, very good. Very good question. Very good question. The brother asked, so it is said that the beard is a sunnah. The beard is a sunnah. Indeed, the scholars say the beard is a sunnah. But what do they mean when they say the beard is a sunnah? Do they mean this technical meaning or the late technical meaning, which means the act which is preferred? Means the first one. Means it is of the general way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It means that it is of the acts of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rather, it is not only that, it is also a command from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَوْفُ الْلِحَى. And in another narration, وَفِّرُ الْلِحَى. And in another narration, أَرْفُ الْلِحَى. أَرْفُ الْلِحَى, وَفِّرُ الْلِحَى. It means grow the beard. Wafiru means let it loose. Arkhu means let it loose. Wafiru means save it. So, this, the scholar said, the beard is a sunnah. But what do they mean by the term a sunnah here? They mean it is of the general way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, the second meaning is not meant. That's why it is unanimously agreed upon, even the four madhabs, all of them agreed upon, that the growing the beard is wajib. But where is the dispute? In the extent which you should grow your beard to. This is a matter of dispute. But the growing, the mere growing of the beard, it is agreed upon that it is wajib. And this explains what the scholars meant when they said it is a sunnah. It means it is a sunnah, yani it is part of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his actions, and the ruling of it is that it's wajib. I hope this answers your question.
What we should do, we should not cut?
That will come later, inshallah. When we speak about jurisprudence, we will mention, inshallah, the details of that. But now, focus on what is most important. What is more important, inshallah, I want you to focus on what is more important. Leave alone those issues that are yani, spoken much about, where there are issues which are more important. Indeed, that is an important issue, no doubt. But there are matters which are the foundations of religion that you have to focus on now you start with inshallah. Now.
The
book
that you just recited to us, can you tell us what it's called?
Yes, the poem is called طبعاً it is Alfiyyatu al-Iraqi. That means the poem of 1,000 verses belonging to al-Iraqi, a scholar of the 700s. And he is actually the Shaykh of Ibn Hajar, if I'm not mistaken. Or the Shaykh of the Shaykh of Ibn Hajar. It's a beautiful poem, and he speaks about the whole biography of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this poem. Nah. He mentions his names, then he mentions his whole name. So we shall mention to you, inshallah, when you mention his whole name, he's saying the same scholar, Al-Iraqi, he's saying, وَهُوَ ابْنُ عَبْدِ اللَّهِ عَبْدُ الْمُطَّلِبِ أَبُوهُ وَهُوَ شَيْبَةَ الْحَمْدِ نُسِبِ أَبُوهُ عَمْرٌ هَاشِمٌ وَالْجَدُّ عَبْدُ مَنَافِ بْنُ قُصَيٍّ زَيْدُ ابْنُ كِلَابٍ أَيْ حَكِيمٍ يَا أُخَيْتُ وَهُوَ ابْنُ مُرَّةَ بْنِ كَعْبِ بْنِ لُؤَيْ. See, the scholars gave much importance to this matter, to the extent that they made it into a poetry to make it easy for you to memorize. You have to know at least the name of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at least his great qualities, Huwa Muhammad, Ibn Abdullah, Ibn Abd al-Muttalib, Ibn Hashim, Ibn Abd al-Manaf, etc. Now, fadl. Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Sunnah, Tawrin.
Sunnah is?
Tawrin. Sunnah,
Tawrin. That will come, inshaAllah, in the rulings of prayer. We shall learn, inshaAllah, the ruling of that, inshaAllah. Yes. No, Ahmed, we didn't say it was derived from the name Muhammad, but Ahmed is a certain form in the Arabic language which is used for preferring something over another. Like you say, Akbar. You have in your language Akbar. What does Akbar mean?
Greater.
Af'al. Akbar. Asghar. A'zam. A'zam, you have the name A'zam as well. A'zam means greater. Akbar means greater in level or in size. Asgha means, yes, smaller. So it is this term, yani this formation of any word, af'al, which sounds like af'al, this is used, you will learn in Arabic, that it is used to prefer something over another. Okay, so the term Ahmed is taken from Alhamd, and Alhamd is praising. So if he is Ahmed, that means he is the best who praises. Okay, just like Akbar, he praises the best way. The one who praises in the best manner is our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that's why his name Ahmed. Now, I hope this is clear.
So we can say that not every sunnah is an act of worship, if it's falling in the fourth category,
yes,
it doesn't.
Yes, not everything which is considered the general way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a sunnah as an act of worship.
So how do
you
differentiate between this and an act of worship?
This is clear from the ahadith. From the ahadith, it is clear that there are signs in the hadith under which the scholars clarify to us that this is not an act of worship, or not meant to be an act of worship, but it is just the only act. Like the type of clothing they used to wear. They did not mean to worship Allah by this clothing, but it was just what they wore at that time. Okay? So this is
silver ring as well.
No, silver ring, etc. So these things, barakallahu fikum, some of what is considered the general way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, some of it is not meant to be an act of worship. Na'am, fadl, yes. Pardon me, I forgot about you. That's all. Fadl.
You spoke about Qulayb and Adab. I've heard two opinions that you start following what Adab and slowly, slowly,
and that's what we're doing.
Exactly. And the other thing, they keep saying this follows Quran. How exactly?
Okay, the brother is asking. We heard that the brother heard two opinions. One says start with one madhab, and the other says follow the Quran and the Sunnah. See, there's no contradiction between the two opinions. If you understand it correctly, there's no contradiction. But the one who says follow the Quran and the Sunnah, there are two possible interpretations to this statement of his. Either he means follow the Quran and the Sunnah directly, And this would imply that he has all the necessary tools to understand the Quran and the Sunnah. And this would also imply that we should pay him a visit at the soonest opportunity we get to learn from him, because he had reached to a level like the great A'imma to derive, masha'Allah, the rulings and say this is haram, halal. So we would like to meet such a person. The other possible interpretation to what he means is that follow the Quran and the Sunnah, putting in consideration the tools you need to learn how to derive from the Quran and Sunnah. If he meant that, you tell him, brother, there's no contradiction. If you follow a madhhab, you are learning how to do so. You are learning how to take from the Quran and the Sunnah. Why? Because there is no book in al-madhhab that you read except they say to every issue, this issue is haram and the proof is so and so and so. And they have taken as a proof so and so and so. And the way this evidence implies this ruling is so and so and so. No book in any madhab that you will read except that you will find to every ruling, and I mean the advanced books in every madhab, to every ruling you will find والدليل so and so and so. I challenge anyone, to bring proof that, or to say that there is no book of jurisprudence that does not relate a ruling back to its evidence. Except that from those big, those big books, there are different types of books in one method. Why? Because the scholars knew that people who are like us, who are going to be not very studious as the people before. So they considered that in us, our heedlessness in us, okay? So they wrote small books like this to start with. Says, okay, you cannot jump right into that whole commotion of knowing all the proofs and how they imply the ruling. And so we're going to give you something small to start with. Start with knowing the most important issues without the evidence for now. Why? Because you want to pray. You cannot say, no, I have to know all the evidence of prayer, then I will pray. No person, sensible person will say that. But now you are in a necessity of knowing, what do I do in this case? If I forget, what do I do? If I forget saying Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, what do I do? If I forget a rak'ah, what do I do? If I forget a sujood, what do I do? Do we say, wait until you know the Quran and the Sunnah, and then understand it as you, I don't know how you'll understand it, but as you want to understand it, then pray? No sensible person will say that. So why have they done those four books, even though in the same madhab they have big books of more than 20 volumes, the thorough detail of every issue with its evidence and how it is understood? Why have they written these books for us? To learn the contemporary issues and matters of our religion in order to pray correctly, to give zakat correctly, to do fasting correctly. That's why you have books there that all people buy. Most people now want concise books, right? Summarized, say, no, I don't want to read too much. I just want to know how to pray. So I take how to pray. I take this book and I read it, and now alhamdulillah, I know how to pray. Those books which are abbreviated and which contain the summation of the rulings of fiqh, do they have their evidence in it?
No.
Do they have most of the books that are abbreviated? Do they have, or do they just teach you how to pray? They just teach you how to pray. Why you're not following the Quran and the Sunnah? See what I mean? So this is based on the Quran and the Sunnah. But simply the scholar does not want you to read a whole lot of pages just to know what to do. So he delayed you knowing the evidence for now until you pray in a correct manner at first. Until you do what is obligatory upon each and every individual. Then if you wish to elevate yourself in the levels of knowledge, no, there's no harm in that, do it. But then there are second levels, books that are a bit higher, that include not only the issues, but the issues and how they are understood. They said, now you are fit and qualified to go to the other level. But if you don't know how to pray, even how to pray, you don't know when to do sujood sahwi. You don't know whether, I'm going to ask a question. If you forget to say Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, do you need to pray sujood sahwi? No? Of course you do. Why? See? Because Subhana Rabbi al-Azim is wajib. And if you leave a wajib, you have to mend it. See? So now, most of us did not know that if you say, you forget to say Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, you do sujood al-sahw. So now what do we do? You say, no, don't take from those books, those madhab books, take from the Quran and the Sunnah. Akhi, all the scholars, they took from the Quran and the Sunnah. And they gave you those real rulings ready. They went through a lot to make easy for you those rulings. So after their research of the whole Sharia, they said, the things which you do, which you forget, where you have to do sujood sahwi for, are so and so and so and so. Instead of you going through all the hadith and figuring out whether you have to do or not, they already have it ready for you. You don't have to do it. This is a point. Another point, you don't have the tools to do it. So I hope this answers your question. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه.